Hello. So, I want to do a little video on ZBrush. It's my first one doing one on ZBrush, and it's a tool that I use very often. Typically, I do all of my modeling in Maya first, and then I export as OBJ and import into ZBrush as an OBJ file. So, I started doing a Yoda, and I've already sculpted out the head. Let's go here. I'm drawing a different shader really quickly. So this is kind of where I'm at right now. I think I'm pleased with the sculpts. I can make some adjustments, but overall, I'm pretty pleased with it. So here's the back of the head. It looks a little sort of pixelated, if you will, as I rotate. And then the HD image comes in as it pauses here. So I'm just rotating around. What I'm doing is I'm holding right click to rotate around. And I do have this on a Cintiq, so I can draw directly on my monitor also, which I'm doing now. And in that case, instead of using right click, I just take my pen and drag it off to the side of the screen where I'm not on the object to actually sculpt on. And then I can go ahead and 360 around. This is sort of just going to cover some of the basics. I always like to keep my perspective on, because when I model like this, this is not how I will see it in a renderable camera. So I like to turn on my perspective to see what it'll look like. And then occasionally I will toggle this on and off to sort of maybe match a reference or something like that, but 90% of the time, I leave my perspective on. The floor reference, if I'm doing just the face, I do not have it on. If I'm doing like a body like this, like a full body sculpt, I will turn it on just for sort of just like a visual reference to kind of keep me grounded in 3D space. It's just a personal preference. From time to time, I turn it off. A lot of times I will, because I'll just be working on, let's say, one part of my sculpt, and then I really don't need it for something where I'm getting into really fine detail in my model in certain parts. So, all I did was just toggle the eyeball on and off. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to sort of just go through some of these basic tools here. If I turn on symmetry, I press X. That'll toggle on my left-right symmetry. And as far as any other settings in this region here that I'm highlighting, the only one I'll ever maybe turn on or off sometimes is my polyframe. So if I turn on my polyframe, this shows my geometry, topology, if you will, on the actual mesh itself. Now, if I go into my geometry, I'm at my highest subdivision geometry, and if I bring this down, let's just say to 2, you'll see, and I'll turn this off now, the difference. Now, one thing from Maya to, or 3ds Max or Blender or whatever, in ZBrush, in this version that I'm using, which is 3.5 R3, in this version of ZBrush, the model will always have hard edge surfacing on it. So it's not going to have that poly, the soft edge on the model. It just doesn't do that. So when we subdivide, it starts to become smoother and smoother. And if you have a slower machine, which some of you may not, it's always good to run through this and let it sort of load at each subdivision. Because going from 2 to 6, in this particular instance, it's going from like a, you know, maybe 20, 30, 50,000 polys to 5.269 polygons. And that's quite a big jump for slower machines. And I myself have this on a laptop from 2012. It's a quad-core i7 with an NVIDIA graphics card. If I remember right, it's a 330 GeForce M, if I remember right. And it's got, I've upgraded it to 16 gigs of RAM, and it's a Sony Vaio F-Series. It's a little noisy. I sometimes compare it to, like, a lawnmower or something, especially when I get into, you know, really high poly counts. But it works. And it's kind of quick. However, based on your own machine, I've found in my own experience to toggle these subdivision levels at one subdivision level at a time when you're scrubbing through them, because it can sort of take the machine and lag it up and even sometimes crash. Now, from there, in my, to sort of break this down, I do have different sub-tools. So, in essence, if you're familiar with any other software that's, you know, it's almost like layers, but different. It's their own mesh. So if I just do the eyeballs, and I can go into my eyeballs and turn my geometry all the way up. Like I said, you don't want to just go from 2 to whatever. I'm going from 3,000 to 3.8 million. I knew, however, it wasn't too much for my PC to handle. However, this is the first time I'm running a screen capture with ZBrush on. So we'll see what happens. And then, a couple other things. One thing to keep in mind, I use Maya much more often than any other 3D software. I am familiar with Blender, 3ds Max. But one thing that you should absolutely take note on is the UV map here. By default from Maya, at least I know for sure from Maya, it flips the V axis, the vertical. So you can, I've become accustomed to just keeping it as is default in the software, and then I flip it in Photoshop afterwards when I apply my texture to Maya. It's just a workflow that I've grown comfortable with. But to show you, this would probably be a better example. And I poly-painted this texture on. If I turn this off, this is actually vertical. So when I apply it into Maya, the map itself, I go into Photoshop and I flip it vertically. So it's just a vertical flip, which is flip V, and it says flip V chords vertically. So if I turn my texture off, I actually have my ambient occlusion map, and that is directly on the mesh at the moment. And that actually takes a lot of PC power to create. It's probably the most computer, I want to say, intensive things to do that I've found in ZBrush. Displacement maps are much more quicker. Normal maps I can do no problem, and at whatever poly count. But when you do an AO, an ambient occlusion, you always want to keep it at a very high poly count to ensure that it gets inside all of these little crevices and cracks to map out when you bring it into Photoshop and apply it to your texture map. So, just to give you an idea, scrub around, you'll start to see these little shadows in these crevices, which are just really, they're just really wrinkles in the head sculpture here, the back of the skull. And you'll see it inside the ear, and obviously under the eyebrow and things like that. Now, and under the lip. Now, anyway, getting to the point. Let's go ahead and turn that back on. So, by default, when you export this, you hit clone texture, texture, and then you do an export, because it'll pop up right here automatically. Let's just do it real quick. Clone texture, You'll see it here. And then you do export. And it exports as a Photoshop file. Now, I can create any type of texture for my poly paint, masking, which is how I created my ambient occlusion, my UV map, etc., etc. Now that we covered some of these, I guess I call them tabs. It's just kind of weirder because I always think of tabs up here. And a lot of people ask, well, by the way, and they think that these are in such a ludicrous order. Because they're like, why isn't this here? It's not like my file, edit, etc. ZBrush does it in a really simple way. It's alphabetically. A, B, C, D, E, blah, 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 all the way through. So it's just an alphabetical layout. Now, getting into actual sculpting. I'm going to, and I haven't showed you how to import these objects. I will in a later video. I guess I just had an itch to just record a little something. And what we're going to do, I'm going to start with my sash here. I could do the arms and just start sculpting on the arms. And let me think, it would be better to show you. I'll do the arms. So I've started to, on the actual clothing here, and all of this, by the way, again, to remind you, and I always like to sculpt, not in skin shade, in matte cap gray. It's a personal preference, and by default, it's always in, not reflected red, matte cap red. I personally like matte cap gray. It's probably like a 3D kind of modeling thing. It's always in gray when you first start, Lambert, if you will. So it's just something I'm comfortable with when I'm modeling or sculpting. So in the hands here, the arms, let's go ahead and turn my polyframe off. And again, just to show you my geometry, and I'm going to turn off my floor for the moment, and I'm even going to just isolate my hands. So here's my Yoda hands for now, and I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to turn polyframe off. It actually uses a little bit more CPU power to display that, especially when you start sculpting on it, because it starts to change. And I'm holding control and right click to zoom in, or second, however you set up your pen on your Cintiq or tablet. And to show you one more thing, I've got my geometry here, and I'm at 3 subdivision levels. So my first subdivision level is 738 polys. And my second is 2,900. My third, and I'm going to subdivide this one more time. Now I'm at 46,000, roughly. So I'm going to start sculpting in, and you still see that rough sort of hard surface edging. And I'm just simply using my standard brush tool. I'm going to turn this off. And I'm just going to go ahead and start painting in here. And as you can tell from just like a normal hand, I haven't really seen references. And I'm going to hold shift to smooth my sculpt out at the moment to just sort of sculpt in here. So what I haven't really looked at references of Yoda's hands on the inside of his hands to see how sort of, does he have the lifeline here? You know, everyone else has a thumb. I'm going to say he probably does. He's probably got a crevice here, here, and at each knuckle corresponding. I think I have one here. Control-Z doesn't work. But again, when you get into higher poly counts, we're talking really high poly counts, you're going to want to... I find it easier, honestly, to just bring it back as subdivision level, erase, and go forward when I start getting into some nitty-gritty details. So, now that I've gotten this far, I'm going to go ahead and just sort of sculpt in some ideas. Now, I typically, when I start doing my base, before I get into custom alphas and things like that, and I'm going to smooth these out, because I'm going to sort of get into the higher detail when I get a little bit more poly. Here, I'm gonna start, I'm gonna press BPH, it's brush, the quick brush tool. P is for, the name, and then H is my quick keyboard, quick pick. There you go, quick pick. So, I have a couple of these just sort of embedded in my brain that I use pretty often. BPH is one of them. I'm going to bring it to a slightly higher, and all I do is right-click on the screen and change my size. And I'm going to start to sort of sculpt in and pinch in this lifeline here. I'm going to smooth this out a little bit. And I like to just run a little bit. Sometimes it's not necessary, but I try to catch just the edge of my sculpt to give it a little bit. Sometimes it's just really too rough, even though it sort of looks really harsh like that. Until I get a little bit higher in poly count, I won't go in too much detail on that. And I guess maybe I'll try here, start to just sort of pinch these off. Now, one thing to keep note of when you're doing this, if you don't already have the topology built in, right, you're actually stretching your polygons quite a bit, and it happens sometimes here and there, and it can be really, when you bring it back in to, let's say, you know, Maya, 3ds Max, Blender, and you import back your low poly mesh, you'll notice that these polys start to, some of them, depending on how extreme you pinch some of these edge loops, can be like right next to each other. And if you're planning on any type of deformation with joints or character rig, etc., it can sort of mess you up a little bit. So when building these things, sort of keep in mind that you want to build it with the notion that you will sculpt on it. And you can always adjust geometry later. It's not a big deal. But it does sort of help, at least in my personal workflow. My preference on modeling, and then, you know, when I get back to rigging, deformation and things like that. I like to try to build in as much as I can beforehand. It saves me a little bit of a headache later. So, let's go ahead back to subdivision 4 and turn off polyframe. And I'm just going to go ahead and do it, and you'll notice that it has invisible faces on the inside of polygons. So this is obviously an open, it's not a closed object. I just imported it open. I didn't need the extra polygons because I have the shirt to cover it. And this arm goes into this region. It's about to the, give or take, a little past the elbow, I want to say. Probably right around here. Now, and let's say I want to turn on my nails. I got my nails here. Maybe I want to start to do a little... Oop, I'm pinching. I wanted to use my standard brush tool. And it looks like I'm only doing this on one side, which I did not want plan on doing, but it doesn't matter. If I press X, there you go. So now let's just say I wanted to go back because I was like, oh no, I wanted to mirror everything and make it perfectly, you know, until I get into the fine details where I want it to be asymmetrical. I want it to be symmetrical up to this point, but asymmetrical when I get here. Bringing it down to lower subdivision levels will totally fix that. And you won't even have to worry about it. But anyway, let's go ahead and jump into, let's say, the body. Right? Here's my Yoda body. I'm going to turn on the sash. And now I've got my sash here. And I'm going to... F, just like in Maya, will automatically zoom and center your object in camera. So I'm going to start to sort of sculpt in here. Oh. And you'll see, actually, where I was just doing some sculpting. So on my sash, I'll go ahead and start to bring the geometry down just a bit. It's a little too high. And I'm going to start to sculpt in some other things. Now, if I hold Alt, Alt digs into my mesh, whereas if I hold nothing, it just sort of sculpts into it. And I'm just trying to get some sort of wrinkle effect here in my sash as I started to here. That's obviously what I was just showing you, the pinch tool. And go ahead here, start to sculpt this and pinch it a little bit. And I'm not really too particular about, like, I'm just trying to make it look like some sort of cloth, you know. Just a little bit of, obviously I want it to be asymmetrical. Cloth is definitely never, unless it's probably skin-tight clothing, symmetrical, and even then your body's asymmetrical also. So I'm starting to just sort of sculpt in these quick little lines in the sash, and then I'll even just bevel out, sort of what I'm calling bevel out, like bump out right around it, and then I'm going to smooth it, and this is, you know, however you want to do it, and then I'll start to sort of get a look that I'm hopefully going for. Down a little bit. If I bring down my subdivision level again, it sort of erases, if you will, better. I'll bring it back up. Not that high. And 5. And I'm going to sort of pinch these in a little bit. And then just smooth them out a little bit. Roughly something like that. And this is sort of my main crease, and it might even be a little too strong. But I think it's alright. And I think as I continue to work my way around the sash, and later I have not added his cloak yet, that I believe once I have his cloak and, you know, his robe, if you will, he'll probably, definitely, this sash will look pretty good. Plus, I gotta texture it and so on and so forth. Anyway, here's just a little rough demo starter kit on how to sculpt in ZBrush. It's the first one I've done. I'll continue recording some of these and show you some progress. But I hope you enjoyed, and you'll see from me soon.